Recorded Books presents The Puppet Master's Apprentice by Lisa DeSelm. Narrated by Liz Pearce. For my daughters, I love you, splinters and all, always. Prologue. I've never had a mother, but I've always had the trees. I hear them still. The joy of the beech bursting with buds, the oak's relief at shedding fall's heavy fortune, the anticipation of winter's slumber with rugged skins bared to the frost. Their voices rise and fall on every twist of the wind, comforting, yet stern when danger draws near. Once a widower walked among them, hunting for fresh wood. The puppet master liked to take his time, feeling the bark for smoothness, measuring width for usefulness, assessing the health of each trunk. He only culled trees who had lived a good life already. He left behind those too young or too warped by the strange forces of nature. At night, as he was taking his rest in a small clearing, a woman appeared at the rim of his firelight. She was old, old beyond old, with skin more leather than flesh. Uncertain whether she was human or a force of nature itself, the puppet master invited her to share the warmth of his fire. She accepted wordlessly, her legs folding to the ground as spryly as a child's. He offered her his supper, though he hadn't much. At last, sated by the meal, the woman began to speak. "You are a solitary man, Gephardt."
"Yes, m'lady."
She knew his name.
"Your heart longs for a companion, a treasure beyond what you can make for yourself."
The old crone's words pierced his heart. The puppet master was alone in the world, save for his creations. His parents were gone. His wife had died in childbirth years before, and the babe with her. He so longed for a companion, for a real family. That searing loneliness was his greatest pain.
"Listen well. Soon the blue moon, the rarest of all moons, will be on the rise,"
the woman prophesied, her voice skittery as a spider's.
"At its waxing, offer up one of your creations, and by the moonlight they will be given breath. Choose wisely who to awaken. First, make a cut, finger or hand will do. With a drop of your own blood, mark for the creature a new heart. By the moon's power, the wood will become a living thing again, born of the earth and your blood. But to complete the change, you must say the words."
"Words, m'lady?"
Gephardt stuttered, shocked at these wild suggestions. Such spells were outlawed, forbidden generations ago. Once, men and women sought to raise power from the earth, to bring wooden carvings to life, or to entreat a heartbeat from sculpted clay. That age ended when a royal conjurer's disastrous spell enabled a king to achieve the opposite. He turned the living to wood. Thanks to his blistering temper, more than a few wooden wives, sons, and stewards were lost to the burn pile. His regime finished in ruin, followed by a ruling heralded far and wide against elemental spells. In an attempt to safeguard the future of the monarchy, all books containing such magic spells were either sentenced to be kept under lock and key or flagrantly destroyed. The latter applied to those still living with magic words tucked within the pages of their memories. Anyone suspected of witchery or sorcery was hunted down and added to the smoking pyres aflame around the royal city. The old elemental spells were lost, their legacy now mere whispered warnings from Mother's lips. Or so the puppet master had thought.
"These are the Blue Moon's words," the woman rasped. "Take heed now, for there's always a cost, and I'll not repeat myself. Bitter moon and solemn blue, blood of earth and sap and dew, wake a second life anew."
"Wait, please, what?"
She silenced him by snapping a twig-like finger to her lips. The woman stood and dusted her tattered skirts, which disintegrated toward her gnarled feet. Then she left, disappearing into the trunk of a broad oak. Stunned, Gephardt doused his fire and made his way home. He feared he'd imagined the whole thing. Had his loneliness driven him to madness? If anyone had seen what he'd seen, or heard those words, they were in danger of being pitched straight into a burn pile. And if he were to go so far as to make a living creature using such magic? If discovered, the creature would be burned as an abomination. Yet, in the weeks that followed, he obeyed the old woman, scorned the law, and made a girl, the daughter he and his wife had longed for. Selecting pieces of the finest linden, he forsook constructing anything else and worked tirelessly on her. He crafted her legs so that they would be sturdy but elegant, the shoulders even and strong. She emerged from the roar, a girl of about 11 years, the same as his own wee one, had she lived. When it came to her face, the puppet master swore his chisel was guided by another hand, the tools already knowing the way to the features sleeping in the wood. The dark hair, the slope of her nose, the wide eyes. She was always there, he claimed, waiting to be set free. When the rare blue moon rose, Gephardt remained sequestered at home, waiting for it to peak in power, fearful of returning to the forest to perform the rite in the open. He closed the shop early, bolting the doors and shuttering the windows. He paced wildly, wearing grooves in the planked floors. The marionette had been finished for 2 days. There was nothing else to do but look at her and hope, however outrageous and pitiful that seemed. He'd asked the old tailor next door to sew him a dress. A new pair of shoes were fashioned by the cobbler. Such requests were not unusual. The puppet master often relied on his fellow artisans to complete his work with their finery. When the moon peaked that fateful night, it was full and lavishly blue, the same shade as the cerulean in the puppet master's paint pots. Its light was a living, ghostly thing. He waited until the rays illuminated his far workshop window, the only one he dared crack open. He held the marionette gently, bathed in moonbeams, as he knelt on the floor. From his pocket he drew a small blade, a long-ago gift from his own father. With a whispered prayer and a deep slice across a scarred fingertip, he painted a heart in the place where a new one might grow. Then he uttered the old woman's clandestine words, the marionette's first lullaby. "Bitter moon and solemn blue." in a rush of joy and heartbreak, with a ripping breath that filled the marionette from the inside out. The wooden limbs became warm flesh. The cleverly fashioned joints on the arms and legs germinated from pins and wire to bones and sinew. A human heart hummed in the small chest. Gephardt's blood spilled through newly strung veins, flooding the marionette's cheeks and prodding her eyelids open. In wonderment, the puppet master and girl looked one another in the eyes for the first time. In those first moments, I was, perhaps, still more wood than girl. It's hard to say. Since a tree cannot move about, the only way for it to travel is to stand through time, the pages of its story pressed deeper inside with each passing year. I keep the memories of these first moments tightly pressed within. There are days when I wonder, if you were to crack me open, could you still count my rings, each significant moment sealed in a new layer to protect it from the elements? My father claims I attempted to stand, but my wobbly legs stumbled in a willowy twirl few dancers would have been graceful enough to manage. Like a leaf fluttering to the forest floor. Then came the puppet master's hearty laugh, and the words that never fail to bring a flood of those early memories rushing back.
And so it was that I discovered your name. Pirouette.
Chapter 1. Tavia's marked plots is nearly full by the time I hitch Burl to our custom-fitted theatre wagon and find an unoccupied corner of the square. Merchant tables and tents unfurl in a patchwork of every kind of ware, both common and exotic, that a Tavian might desire. Burl stands placidly, a bastion of calm among the shrieks and high-pitched chatter of those bargaining their way to fuller stomachs and emptier purses.
"A puppet's pull goes far beyond its strings," Papa often reminds me. "Marionettes aren't just for children. A story, a good one, will grip any audience, young or old."
I desperately hope the audience will be gripped today. I'm already sweating and hungry as I set up our little stage. The ridgepoles snap neatly together, and over them I hang a tailored shade to hide myself and the marionettes sleeping in their trunk. I lower the side panel like a drawbridge, revealing rich velvet curtains dangling at the ready. The stage is eye level for children. Though, as my father anticipated, adults linger in the back of the crowd to watch, too. A puppet show in the Marktplatz is always a welcome diversion. Afterwards, the generous will show their appreciation by placing coins on a narrow ledge bordering the stage. On a good day, I scoop up francs by the handful before returning home. I need today to be one of those days. Papa needs more paint. Again. Inside the wagon, spools of canvas swing from the ceiling, backgrounds that I can lower and change depending on the story. My fingers stroll through the scenes, each one bearing the evidence of my father's skilled brushstrokes. I select one with a familiar-looking tower in the distance. The crest on the tower's banner is indistinguishable. But the flaming red colour means only one thing to me. The Margrave. Tavia isn't a particularly large territory. There's the sprawling village and surrounding farms, then the inner district where the Maker's Guild and other merchants live and work, all wrapped around the central Marktplatz. The Margrave operates as overseer, ruling from his estate at Wolfspire Hall, thanks to an ancient appointment of the von Idle family bloodline. He answers only to King Nikos II, who rules our lands from a city I've only ever heard whispers of, Ellenbrook. The king and his rules are so far from here they may as well not exist. Not for us. The Margrave is king here. With the stage set, I close the curtain ceremoniously, giving a sly wink to the gaggle of children already gathering at the theatre's edge. Anticipation builds in me each time I perform, like steam swirling in a tea kettle. I settle myself on a three-legged stool and slide open the locks of the trunk with a satisfying chink. The marionettes I perform with are some of our best, each about the length of my arm, painstakingly carved and painted and fitted with costumes that rival any larger stage. Carefully, I lift each performer from the silk-lined depths of their resting place. I hang the ones I'll need later from hooks to keep their strings from becoming tangled. I select a marionette I carved myself a few years ago, a peasant girl. She's rough compared to the work I can do now, but the unrefined quality of her face suits her. Tassels of dark yarn escape the kerchief around her head, and a smattering of freckles dance across her nose. I choose her companion for my opening scene, a grey donkey whose head bobs on its own string. It's taken years of patient study to become a puppet master's apprentice, to learn how to work with wood to produce the pieces I see in my mind's eye. But putting on a show with marionettes, that comes as easy as breathing. I can almost feel myself slipping through the wooden controls, sliding down the strings into the armature. Voices bubble up out of their faces, and just like that, a story is born.
Masters and mistresses, girls and boys, I offer for your amusement a tale that is sure to charm and delight. A story that will make you laugh and weep. A myth that will stir your very soul.
Oh, get on with it, you laggard!
Harps a man's voice from beyond the curtain.
Before we're all as old and grey as Wolfspire's stones.
I pause and grin. Without fail, there's a heckler in every crowd. While my audience cheers, I quickly draw the curtains closed. It's important to never let them see the mess of props I must set to rights before the next show.
Hide the hands behind the strings, as my father would say.
According to the sound of coins filling the wagon ledge, my tail hit its mark. When I reach out to gather them up, I can't ignore small pairs of hungry eyes tracking my penny francs like slices of hot bread. I motion to two hollow-looking faces to join me at the back of the wagon and tuck a few coins into each open palm. Squealing, the children run, slipping away into the crowd. The stand of maple trees at the edge of the marked plots murmurs approvingly, their gold-tinged leaves rattling like treasure in a tinker's coat. As I'm resetting the stage and carefully adjusting my puppets, four sharp taps sound at the wagon door.
Pirouette, it's me!
Bran's voice makes my pulse pick up. I unlatch the door, surprised to see his brown eyes flitting anxiously across the marked plots. Instead of greeting me, he climbs right inside the wagon and snaps the door shut behind him. Though it's only built for one puppeteer, there's room enough for both of us to crouch in the warm, dim interior if we squeeze together closely. I don't mind.
You had quite an audience going there, Piero.
Indeed. I smile, shaking the bag of coins. Bran's handsome face is not smiling.
They're still out there.
The little beggars.
No. The Duke and his guards, he says pointedly,
and that big man who's always shadowing the Margrave, the one who does all his dirty work.
He leans in, talking low.
I made a delivery and saw you had the whole square enraptured, including the Duke. Von Idle had such a strange look on his face, like a man seeing the sun for the first time. I don't like it.
The Duke is here?
That's one downside of puppeteering. I can't see the audience while I perform. I've only ever seen the Margrave's son, Duke Laszlo von Idle, from afar. I glimpsed him once riding in the carriage procession beside his father, a pale shadow of a boy in a man's body. As a child, the Duke was sickly, never going anywhere without a nurse and a rasping cough. Some sort of lung-wasting disease, they said, the same that killed his mother. The Margrave kept his son confined on their castle estate, bringing in tutors and the best doctors, while keeping the rest of Tavia at bay. Though that was years ago, he's still widely assumed to be too delicate to rub shoulders with commoners. The Duke is rarely seen beyond Wolfspire Hall's gates, let alone watching marionette shows at the Marktplatz.
I wasn't doing anything wrong, Bran. Father is so busy and I must buy more paint, I whisper. The wooden soldiers for the Margrave are bleeding us dry.
I know, Pierrot.
A tight, stubborn shame spreads across my face, which was so triumphant just moments ago.
It was just a theatrical.
I know, Bran says sympathetically. But you need to take care, Pierrot, especially if you're going to tell stories like that last one.
He adds, eyebrows raised. It's true that my new story could easily be interpreted as satire. A selfish king's rage turns him into a wolf, and in the end, the wolf is struck down by the peasant girl's well-aimed arrow. The crowd loved it. Bran pets the wolf's shaggy grey head from atop a pile of marionettes.
It's not as if the wolf didn't deserve his end. It was a masterful tale, he smirks. But you know as well as I, the wrong ears listening.
I'll be careful,
I promise, pulling the wolf from his grasp. Shaken, I peer through the small space between the top of the stage and the curtain. If I tilt my head at just the right angle, I have a narrow view of the crowd. I make out a familiar dark shape across the square. Baldric, the Margrave's steward, hovering around the Duke like a crow on a carcass. The Duke, a fair-haired man with a red crest on his jacket, surveys the sights from in front of a posse of guards. He strolls the square, looking like a nobleman who knows his place, far above the rest of us. When his gaze turns to my wagon and its audience, though he can't possibly see me, his eyes lock onto it with a strange air of possession. My stomach twists at the unwelcome sight.
The Margrave still keeping you hard at it?
Bran prods me with an elbow.
Still working on a new order,
I mumble, watching the Duke's men strut about.
Lately it's always wooden soldiers, more and more soldiers. Papa wears his fingers to the bone from dawn to dusk. Sometimes I think if I have to crack open another pot of Von Idle Red, I'm going to scream.
A line of worry stitches itself above Bran's nose. It only serves to make his face more distracting.
It's business, Bran. What else can we do?
I sigh.
You and the tailor aren't turning down requests for the marionettes' uniforms, are you? What is it to us if the ruler of Tavia desires a collection of wooden soldiers?
It's beyond me to wonder why a grown man would want life-size toys. But I don't like the way he's driving you and Gep into the ground. You already work with your nose to your chisel entirely too much, Pirouette. I shrug.
We're makers, it's what we do.
You don't bite the hand that feeds you.
Unless it's squeezing your throat.
Well, I can't complain, I say sharply. Papa needs me. We'll come out all right. We always do.
Bran brushes his fingers against my arm in solidarity, and my cheeks catch flame. That's been happening a lot lately. Then he sneaks out of the wagon, just as skillfully as he came in. Bran's words sting, but we can't afford to balk at the Margrave's requests. A year ago, when my father received the first Grand Commission for an order of life-size marionettes, our little shop was barely scraping by. My father is an artisan of the highest degree, but his beautifully carved dolls, toys, and puppets aren't quite enough to keep us out of patched socks and worn boots. We've always had just enough. Papa's always been adamant that we stick to our craft, our calling to produce clever and delightful work, regardless of how much money it brings us. So, when orders started pouring in from Wolfspire Hall, we weren't in a position to refuse. Gold is gold. Determined not to let the Duke's presence rattle me, I wipe the sweat from my hands and return to work. This time, I choose a common hearth tale about a greedy baker who refuses to sell his own bread. The baker gorges himself until he literally bursts from his gluttony. Everyone's favourite part. A tale without the slightest hint of magic or royal mockery that no one could object to, be they peasant girl or duke. I will be careful, I confide to a grandmotherly marionette as I pluck her from the trunk. I find comfort in her softly bent back and wizened nut-brown face. But you and I know that careful is not the same as silent, is it, old one? Indeed, she whispers back. Chapter 2. Home. The place where I awoke to a new beginning, startled to find myself in sudden possession of a body and a beating heart, and something else altogether foreign. A father. Inside Curio, the air is spiced with glue and lacquer, the floor littered with curls of wood shavings that multiply no matter how often I sweep up. You can't help but admire our shelves, stacked and layered like the best kind of birthday cake, overflowing with toys. Jaunty little wooden men with sticks glued to their backs to make them dance look down upon a menagerie of animals, each more splendid than the next. There are snarling tigers, mysterious elephants, galloping horses, and the great beasts of the sea. The monstrous whale and fearsome squid. Intricate wooden puzzles are tucked into baskets, each piece smoothed to perfection, their mysteries ready to confound minds for many a pleasant evening. Brigades of tiny soldiers line up in rows, waiting for a battle-thirsty master to put them to work. My stomach sinks when I see the soldiers now. I wish the Margrave desired toy soldiers instead of the larger-than-life ones he demands. And all around, strung from the ceiling or sitting precariously on perches, hangs the pinnacle of his work, the marionettes for which my father is known far and wide. Waiting to spring to action are elegantly coiffed ladies, bashful gentlemen, brash sailors, and sweet little shepherdesses. Some are as small as my hand, others as hefty as the wooden stool behind the counter. Creatures from every old hearth tale and fantastical childhood dream wait, poised for a player's hands to give them voice and motion. I love the marionettes best of all. My father is a born maker. from the moment he first picked up a piece of wood and a knife as a young boy. Gephardt Leiter has been making the things he loves come to life. That love is evident in every nook and cranny of Curio. Several of the marionettes are my own creations. My father began training me as his apprentice as soon as he saw I had an inclination toward the work. Once I proved myself capable of more than just sweeping up sawdust and sharpening tools. He taught me how to select the best pieces of wood, how to trace shapes onto a rough board of linden or holcer, and then, bit by bit, how to transform those rough outlines into curves that speak of movement and expression. My tastes run toward the wild and wondrous. Fairy folk and gnomes, lumbering giants and fleet-footed elves, creatures that haunt my daydreams and tiptoe around my nights. After almost 7 years, I still find the process utterly thrilling. If they knew my past, some might think it odd that I am so drawn to carving up the very thing I used to be. But woodworking is my native tongue. I relish the grain against my hands and dust beneath my fingernails. The satisfaction of polishing a piece until it gleams. It connects me with the deepest part of myself. That secret history only Papa is privy to. Ducking through a curtain, I find him in the workshop, the very heart of Curio. As he sands away at a soldier's rigid torso, his spectacles ride dangerously low on his bulbous nose and his shaggy grey hair brushes against the rims. I set down the paints I picked up on my way back from the marked plots.
Was there enough, Pirouette?
Yes, Papa, just barely. I think we're depleting the chromatist supply.
Well, after nearly 90-some soldiers' worth, I shouldn't wonder, he mutters, tossing a scrap into a jumbled corner behind his workbench.
Back here, every table is overrun with tools and stubs of dark grease pencil. Pots of glue drip slowly, and dust motes sail the air, thick as fog. I stop to run my fingers across an emerging face, staring skyward as the iron jaws of a vice lovingly grip its skull. With his big shoulders hunched to his ears, Papa concentrates on refining the chest of the soldier so that one of Taylor Soren's uniforms will fit snugly as a second skin. The Margrave's orders were very specific. The marionettes are to be as tall as a man, each outfitted with a uniform the tailor would supply. And the faces must be unique, no two alike. I've spent the last year toiling at Papa's side on untold numbers of eyebrows, noses, and lips until my fingertips were stained and calloused. We've delivered dozens of the soldiers to the Margrave's estate, and just received an order for more. I sit down on an empty stool and poke at an abandoned half-eaten apple. If I didn't leave him bits of food scattered about, Papa would forget to eat. He's been so focused on meeting the Margrave's absurd deadlines. Papa?
Yes, Poppet?
Why does the Margrave really want the soldiers? Just when I think we're done, a new order arrives. My father halts the sanding block in his hands, nudging his spectacles up with a dirty shirt sleeve. I see the dazed look of a man getting far too little sleep.
I don't know, Pierrot. I've pondered on it much myself. The young Duke is still an avid collector of marionettes, so the steward says. He must grow restless, cooped up there as he's always been. Perhaps they are his only source of amusement. I'm sure the Margrave placates the lad any way that he can. Of course, it's reckoned by some that the Margrave might prefer to name our Emmet as heir. though I doubt we'll ever see that come to pass. I can't imagine the young Duke would ever take kindly to his father's bastard, assuming his rightful seat, though we all know who would make the better Margrave.
He muffles the last bit under his breath and resumes sanding. I am no stranger to the history of the Margrave's two sons. Emmett Schultz, the clockmaker, is a good friend and long-standing member of the Makers Guild, and the closest I've come to having a brother. He and his mother Anka have spent many an hour at our hearth. Years before the birth of the young Duke in Wolfspire Hall, the Margrave forced a dalliance with Anka, a pretty widow who'd inherited the clock shop from her late husband. Though he never officially declared his first son, the Margrave never concealed Emmett's existence, much to the ire of his fragile Margravina back at home.
Whatever the reason for these soldiers, Poppet, it's not our concern. We must be grateful for the work, for it's buying you a new pair of boots and a dress, and me a much-needed sawblade. And then I intend to set some money aside for you. Seems like we never get caught up enough to put anything aside for tomorrow. And
he pauses to blow a fresh pile of dust from the soldier's body.
Speaking of tomorrow, we must go gather more wood.
I want to let my father sink back into his work, but I worry what will become of us after the Margrave's commissions. I can't keep it in, can't help but give voice to the fear that's been trickling into my mind for weeks. Do you think, Papa, that the Margrave or the Duke somehow knows about me? Papa jolts, dropping the sanding block on the soldier's stomach. On his face, buried beneath the exhaustion and determination, I see something I have been desperately trying not to see these past months. Denial laced with fear.
Surely not, Pierrot.
He lowers his voice to a terse whisper.
No one else in all of Tavia knows about the Blue Moon's magic, except me and you. And you have told no one.
Never.
Then it's impossible,
he says resolutely, returning to the soldier. But haven't you wondered, Papa, about the timing of it all? Until recently, I'd assumed the Margrave was hardly aware we existed. He'd kept to himself for years, rarely entering the village life to do more than wave a gloved hand in the square at yearly proclamations or parade the Duke around in a carriage. There was little contact with the Makers Guild and the common folk, beyond the odd bit of tailoring and tinkering or the occasional request of a puppet for his son.
It's been nearly 7 years since the last Blue Moon. Do you think...
Impossible!
My father growls low, ending any hope of further conversation.
Speak of it no more. You know better, Pierrot. Now fetch me that spool of wire. I must attach these arms.
Pressing my lips into a tight line, I hunt for the spool and find it tipped against an empty jar of paint. I hand it over without speaking. Papa can be brusque, but he's never brushed me off like this before. This is new. Along with the tremors in his hands and the drooping bend of his back, each soldier built seems to sap a little more of his strength. I decide I will try his method. Push down my reservations by working harder. All will be well if we can just finish these orders on time. I sit on my worn stool with my small back against his mountainous one and dip a brush into some black lacquer. Though I'm weary of soldiers, it's always a thrill to watch wooden eyes open for the first time, the fine fringe of eyelashes growing under my brush. When I begin to paint the lips, using the Margrave's red, the soldier interrupts my concentration. Like the trees, marionette voices drift from their wooden cores to my ears, speaking in their faint echoes. "We know who you are," he mutters darkly. "Sister, carved of the same vein and forged in secret. We remember." A thick drop of red escapes my brush and smudges against the corner of the soldier's mouth, pasting him with a leering grin. Hurriedly, I grab a rag and wipe it away. But the damage is done, the stain too lurid for the rag to erase. I glare at the head not yet attached to its body. Picking up my own sanding block, I take pleasure in roughly grinding the paint away. In my haste, the lips are gouged, leaving this soldier scarred. No matter. After all, the Margrave requested that the soldiers appear real. None of us escape becoming real without a few scars. Chapter 3.
Pirouette, wait up!
An eager voice rises above the din of wagon wheels on the cobblestones. Just near home, Bran catches up to me. I can't help but smile at the sight of him. His face can scarcely be seen, buried beneath a mountainous armload of fabric. He grins at me sideways from behind the rich-hued bolts piled in his arms.
"I see it was another good day for the theatrical arts," he says, referencing the pots of fresh paint swinging in my arms after another market day.
"I don't think you can see anything of the sort, mostly because I don't see how you can see anything at all," I snort, watching as Bran's shins meet an apple seller's crate. He stumbles but catches himself, managing to keep hold of the bundle in his arms. As the tailor's son and chief delivery boy of the Golden Needle, Bran Sorin could almost navigate the village sight unseen. Almost.
"You coming to the next guild meeting?"
I nod as we stop below a sign with curio etched in winding black script. "Planning on it?" Bran's grin crinkles the corners of his eyes.
"Save you a seat?"
"Same as always."
"Always."
He winks conspiratorially and steps backwards into the Golden Needle without looking, the door swinging open to the tinkle of bells and a happy shriek from one of his younger sisters.
"Bran's back, Papa!"
The Golden Needle nestles next to Curio, in a long, leaning row of workshops that house their owners in narrow second-floor quarters. The tailor, Benito Sorin, moved in just 2 years ago when I turned 16. He and his wife Gita opened the Golden Needle in the sunny space next door, and suddenly a whole batch of Sorins, 8 in total, overflowed like bunting from every window and door. This included Bran, the oldest whose tiny attic room shares a wall with mine. I made the discovery one day when I opened my little cupboard beneath the rafters and saw strange objects mingling with my own. Inside lay a wooden box with a bee carved upon the lid, a worn measuring tape used for learning the tailor's trade, and oddities like shiny rocks rubbed smooth, a bird's egg, a pocket watch whose face had been rearranged, an assortment of tiny tools, and a bag of coins. A note hastily scrawled on a scrap of receipt read,
"I see that this is a safe place for secrets. I'll keep mine with yours, if you don't mind. Bran Sorin."
I did mind, and I told the new boy next door as much when I reached in and poked through what I previously thought was the back of the cupboard. It swung open to the foreign space of his room. He was crouched directly on the other side, as though he'd been waiting for me to open the door. "I do mind, you know," I insisted, trying to dampen my curiosity at being afforded a window into a stranger's room. It was the very mirror of mine, with a sloping ceiling and a small window resting above wooden slat floors. His bed was draped in a soft grey spread, and I could see a pair of smart leather boots tipped over in its shadow.
Why?
Asked the boy from the other side of the cupboard shelves.
Because this cupboard is mine, I said defensively.
It seems to me that it is ours. It opens for both of us. Seems like we should share it, he said confidently. It is a cupboard with two doors.
I bristled.
I was here first.
But not really, he replied in a steady voice that made me want to linger in front of the cupboard,
though I initially contemplated slamming it shut in his face.
Someone else was here long before us. Haven't you ever wondered who they were?
They?
The person who built the cupboard. Or persons. Clearly, they built it like this for a reason. I wonder if it was an old spinster, shut up in the attic, kept hidden by a vicious master to spin golden threads. Perhaps this cupboard was her only means of sending secret messages to the outside world through the lonely housewife who took pity on her from next door.
What?
I said, taken aback.
Or maybe it was built by a pirate, retired here after a life on the sea. A man now sadly bedbound, his body ravaged by drink and overwork. He would give away his gold to his many illegitimate children next door, coin by coin, administered daily through the cupboard so that he might never have to touch them, and thereby acknowledge all that he had squandered and lost.
I stared at the boy through the cupboard, mesmerized by his words and enthralling dreaminess. I had never imagined that my cupboard had other lives before me, or that it would open a door to another world, Bran's world. From that night on, I couldn't close the cupboard door on him. After agreeing upon a secret knock to signal to one another, we began a series of hushed conversations through the cupboard. We would talk about our work, our lessons, or the mundane trifles of our day, sometimes traipsing into the more uncertain territory of the past and our dreams for the future. Despite our closeness, Bran didn't know, and must never know, the truth about me. No one could. Tonight, the cupboard is open while I lie on the floor, my head upon my pillow, bare feet tucked up against the wall where it slopes steeply into the roof. All I can see of Bran through the open shelves are his hands, fluidly stitching the long seam of a soldier's stiff linen shirt, his needle moving like miniature flashes of lightning against a white sky. I love his hands. Always so agile and sure. My own often feel at odds with themselves, unless they have a chisel or a piece of wood beneath them. You really should tell them, I plead for the thousandth time, my voice drifting through the narrow space of the cupboard, where it meets Bran's finely shaped ears and disappears in the light of his room. A sigh escapes through to my side.
I will.
When?
Soon.
You've been saying soon for months.
Soon always comes quicker than we think, Pirouette.
You have to give your parents time to prepare.
I know,
Bran says a little too roughly.
Emmett says there's no rush. In the meantime, I've sworn him to secrecy about my plans to apprentice with him. I'll tell them when I'm ready.
It's no secret that Taylor Sorin hopes to pass the golden needle onto his eldest son. But Bran spends every moment he can spare at Schultz's clock shop, reveling in the stable purr of ticking clocks and marching gears. Though lately, Emmett spends most of his waking hours aloft in the high gables of the Rathaus, charged by the Margrave with repairing the massive, two-storied Glockenspiel gracing the town hall. The clockmaker has become Bran's hero, His new choice of vocation will hit his parents hard. But with time, I'm sure they will come to accept it. Bran is not. Tired of trying to change his mind, I pluck a tiny wooden dancer from the shelf in the cupboard. She's the first toy the puppet master made for me. A little ballerina whose legs dangle with impossibly straight posture. Her pointed toes shod in painted slippers lacing to her knees. Prima ballerina, I named her then, delighted with this gift from the warm, gentle man who said I could call him father. Dark brown hair, the same shade as my own, dashes across her forehead, topped off by a wooden bead for a bun. I love her still.
So, what about you?
Bran's voice interrupts my memories. What about me?
You can't keep ignoring the truth.
I look through the cupboard, blood rushing to my head. The sensation jolts me as it always does. I'm always surprised by how hot and immediately blood flows from one place to another in my body against my will. What does he mean? I've always been so careful.
When are you going to say something to Gephardt? Get him to see reason. He can't possibly go on like this. Both of you are exhausted. Gep doesn't look good, Pirou.
He's fine, I say shakily, trying to convince myself as much. We're fine.
Fine is for kettles of fish. You are not fine. Neither of you.
I rub my dry and bleary eyes, feeling the delicate clink of Prima's legs against my cheek as I cradle her in my hand. It was past midnight when I left my father sound asleep at his workbench and tiptoed up to my room, too tired to prod him toward his own sleeping quarters. I'm just grateful he's actually getting some sleep. You know we have no choice, Bran. The Margrave won't pay us until we deliver this next dozen. And with the money we've had to spend on paint and supplies, his quoted price will earn us a little overage, but still. My father must finish the soldiers, and I must help him.
If only there were magic words you could utter to render all those pieces finished in a second.
Bran groans sleepily.
If only.
People like us don't have the luxury of magic, I replied softly. Not anymore. You know that.
Who believes any of that hogwash anyways?
Bran asks.
Seems like it's mostly superstitions. A bunch of old hearth tales, that's all. There's always a good lesson or a bit of truth in them, like the stories you perform in your wagon. But real spells? Words with power? It's always struck me as funny that the Margraves are so fearful of such things.
My heart constricts at his words. Gephardt always asserted our Margrave is the strictest of them all. Erling considers it a great honor to lock up or burn any supposed conjurer. It was his great-grandfather who started the whole trouble in the first place, that first unruly king of Ellenbrook, who recklessly destroyed most of his family, nearly wiping out his line. Closer to home, the story of old Josipa still rings in my ears. When I was just past what my father marked as my 12th birthday, a Tavian healer known as Old Josipa was out gathering herbs, bits of bark and roots for her poultices and salves. A child happened to follow her and heard her chanting. The child came running back, telling all who would listen that the old woman was speaking to the earth. In return, plants rose up from the ground, their leaves leaping right into her basket. Even though the medicines old Josipa collected were the very things needed to soothe a fever or calm an upset stomach, and she only used her magic for the good of others, it mattered not. When the child's tale made its way to the Margrave's ears, old Josepa was seized and made an example, her poor body lashed to a pole and tossed on a burn pile like a dried shock of wheat. I'd had nightmares for months after, fearing that old Josepa's fate would someday be my own. I must have fallen quiet for too long, for the next thing I know, a hand extends toward me, breaching the empty space between our walls. I sit up and stare at it. Bran wiggles his fingers and I instinctively drop the little ballerina and place my hand, calloused and small, in his own eager and warm one. Looking at the spaces between our treasures, I can see only parts of Bran, mere slices of the fabric of his face, a strip of eyes shaded by serious brows, and then, below that, a firm and sympathetic mouth. He squeezes my hand, and a flicker of heat trails up my arm. For a moment he looks like he wants to say something, but isn't sure how to form the words. Bran usually has no trouble finding words when he needs them.
Pirouette,
I watch him search for what comes next, very aware of his hand holding mine. I marvel that in the 2 years since we first opened this cupboard, Bran has somehow become my dearest friend. I can't imagine my days without his quick and easy smile, without noticing the way his hair curls up at his collar, when his mother gets too busy to give him a haircut, and the way it looks endearingly ragged when one of his sisters does it for him. Bit by bit, like a scrap of sandpaper wearing away a rough edge, Bran has worn down my defenses. All the stiffness, shyness, and quietude of my earlier years. By all accounts, he knows me best, at least as much as you can know someone without truly knowing their past. Papa long ago instilled in me the consequences of revealing my origin to anyone else. It would only endanger them as well as me. Of course, Bran's heard the yarn my father told when, out of the blue, a quiet slip of a girl appeared at his side. My mother died in childbirth, and I was sent away to be raised by my grandmother until I was old enough to join him in his shop. Gephardt repeated the fable so many times, and with such confidence, that my newly formed ears absorbed the words like truth, and I repeated it as my own. I've always paid a price for it, whether it's a misfiring of the magic that made me, or a natural effect of my wooden origins. I've learned that any time I tell a lie, there are consequences, painful consequences.
Pirouette,
Bran nudges me.
You know that you can trust me, right? That I care about you more than I have the words to say.
In spite of his sweetness, all I can think is that if Bran really knew that something about me is both human and other, he would be afraid for me, afraid of me. I can't bear that. Bran sighs again, circling the back of my hand with his thumb. My breath catches in my throat.
Just don't forget that I'm here, wooden soldiers or not, Margrave or not. Someday, I'll have enough to strike out on my own, and you and Gephardt will never need worry about money. I'll help.
Bran.
We could be...
Bran! I cut him off, half delighted and half terrified of what he might say next. More than anything, I want a future with Bran. A chance to be loved the way the milliner loves the milkmaid, with a heart that feels full to the brim of happiness. But it always seems happiness only ever hovers near. a wisp of flame ready to vanish with my next breath. Bran deserves a girl who is fully human, not one whose very existence could condemn him to the keep. He looks at me expectantly through the shelves, waiting.
This is just work, I reassure him. It's not forever. Surely the Margrave and the Duke will run out of room to hold all their toys.
Soon our days will return to normal.
Maybe, Piro.
He leans in, gripping my hand. But normal or not, I want more than this for you. I dare to read from the hungry look in his eyes that he wants more from me, too. My heart swells with something dangerous and thrilling. Bran, I ask, a smile on my lips, offering him the only thing I can right now. The comforting words that have closed every clandestine meeting between our cupboards since we were 16.
See you tomorrow? Same as always?
Always,
he repeats softly, eyes shining in the candlelight. With regret, he releases my hand and waits for me to be the first to close the cupboard door. I shut it slowly, feeling the same sense of loss I always do when the knob locks into place. Placing my hand over the door, I leave it to rest, foolishly hoping to feel Bran's pulse from the other side. My heart wants Bran Sorin. I can't deny it. But the danger of loving someone is that the closer you get, the more exposed you become. And just like a single lie will work itself out through my skin, I fear the truth will do the same, splintering apart anything good we might have. Far sharper than any lie, I've learned the truth has a way of coming out. Always. Chapter 4. I begin my usual morning duties by tying on my apron, unlatching the front door and dusting the shelves. Papa hasn't come downstairs yet. He must be still asleep. I'm glad. I don't like the feverish look in his eyes, the sweat I've seen beading his brow. I linger on the marionettes today with duster in hand. Adjusting a crooked arm here, draping a tangled string more loosely there. Each one is so unique, so lovely. It almost pains me to look at them.
We are not so different, you and I,
one of my wise bearded wizards advises when I tug his handle to make him sit up straight. The tip of his pointed hat knocks the shelf above.
You have strings too, he mumbles, strings you cannot see, but that move you all the same.
Thankfully, the wizard's philosophizing is interrupted by raucous feet bursting through the door to the ring of doorbells. I turn to see the candlemaker's twins, both boys, blonde, impish, and hardly able to contain themselves. They are regular visitors, but even so, I can only tell them apart on a good day. Their mother dresses them in different colored caps, Dieter in red and Gustav in green. But whether they keep to their correct color depends on their mood.
Is the puppet master here? I've saved all my penny francs, Miss Pirouette.
The boy, who should be Dieter, says breathlessly.
He saved them all for weeks and weeks. We need some more wooden men for our battalion,
adds Gustav.
We're preparing for a great battle,
Dieter says seriously, his blonde sheaf of hair bobbing in his eyes.
Are you? I reply. That sounds quite dangerous. And who are we fighting this time? Dragons, Miss Pirouette.
Gustav, at least I think it's Gustav, pipes up.
There are loads of them here in Tavia. They've escaped from the high mountains in Brylov, didn't you know? And if we aren't careful to watch for them, Father says we'll all be burned to a crisp. A crisp,
his brother adds knowingly.
Indeed. Well, I know the puppet master would love nothing more than to help you fight off those pesky dragons. But since he's resting at the moment, will those do?
I point to the toy soldiers on a low shelf, each with a tiny face and cap and weapon to bear. Now, soldiers can be useful in battle.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.